when it blows through my bones. I got a dose for wanna know more, cause it's about what I got to show. Vítam towarzysze, this is Palinkaj, and we're doing Big Brain University live episode on Finbull's Commune. And the first video we have to start here is The Market Will Set You Free. So let's just get right the fuck into this video.
Take a fact. There is no substitute for free market capitalism. Take a close look at this. Jonathan Haidt, the noted New York University psychologist, calls it the most important graph in the world. Why does he say that?
Wait, stop. What is this graph? What is this graph?
It's the most important graph in the history of the world, or whatever.
Years GDP. Wait, what? What do you mean GDP? What was the GDP in fucking ancient Rome? What is this guy talking about?
The GDP in ancient Rome was the same as in the Middle Ages and as in the 1800s.
See, as you can see by this graph.
They didn't measure GDP back.
The global GDP has been the same for about 13,000 years, and then suddenly in the 1800s there was a rapid jump in global GDP.
So, well, that's when they started measuring it. So
that's from the Roman Empire all the way up until fucking the Victorian era. The GDP was the same at all times.
Yeah, man. Babylon should adopt capitalism, man. Shit's kind of fucked. I mean, look at that graph.
Then we had capitalism, and that that's what made everything just jump.
It's just so stupid.
Inescapable fact. There is no.
This guy's not even an economist. He's a psychologist.
Capitalism,
nice.
As a promoter of human prosperity. Let it be noted that Haidt...
Wait, so what was the point of that graph then? If it's about human... Is GDP supposed to be the measure of human prosperity?
Yes.
Why is Six Flags guy talking to me?
Don't question it. Like, why do you honestly think there's going to be some, like, actual facts and logic in this? Like...
Idea
it's just going to be like,
when hard evidence stares him in the face, he's not going to look away. The graph is based on the research conducted by the late British economist Angus Madison. The numbers along the x-axis are years, 2,000 of them. The number on the y-axis are dollars, all of them. Divided by the number.
How stupid do you have to be like for him to like he has to slowly explain this to you, like
all of the dollars.
They only had $2,000 in ancient Rome, dude.
No, not even.
Terrible.
Not even. They didn't even have
they had zero.
They had less.
Well, dollars weren't invented yet.
$300 GDP per capita.
That sucks. Some guy actually researched and this is what he came up with. I mean, can you imagine like if you were like doing your university doctorate thesis or something, and then you came up with this data, it would be like, okay, buddy. Yeah, like, okay, this is the economic history of the world.
So it turns out when they started printing dollars, that the amount of dollars actually went up. And that's my thesis.
Well,
so,
I think that there's like some chance that this graph is like at least a little bit true, just because like the population rate, the population growth, like has a very similar curve, so it could easily.
Well, obviously, you would expect like probably exponential growth, like of GDP over human history, but you probably wouldn't expect this. Like literally nothing happened.
This is a flat
literally
line.
Nothing happened.
This is a flat line up until 1750.
How do you like compare GDP, like modern GDP, to like fucking ancient era, like gold coins and shit? It doesn't even make any sense.
Cavemen, rise of Rome, fall of Rome, it's all just a zero. Nothing, no difference.
It's what's called GDP per capita, which is the world's economic output divided by its population.
Hold on,
GDP is considered the best measurement of a country's standard of living. And in this case, the world's standard of living. Often when I show this graph to students, I get...
Well, standard of living is a very slippery term, because it just means how much money you're spending.
Yeah,
that's all it
means. No, standard of living, at least as it's recorded right now, does not actually take into account, especially more recently. There's so many factors that standard of living doesn't take into account. For example, they don't take into account the cost of owning a motor vehicle in standard of living. So there's so much wrong with how we perceive standard of living in capitalism. But not only that, the GDP is just not a good, reliable source on...
Well, it's like if you... Let's say we have one person in capitalism who has a home, gets food, gets education in a university and uses public transport and has health insurance. Then in socialism, we have the same person, but he gets everything else for free. He just pays a little bit of rent and a tiny amount for food. He's going to have the same exact things, but his standard of living is going to be minuscule because he's spending so little money.
Yeah.
It's just the impact of the Industrial Revolution. So I show them another chart by the Madison Project.
Same
this
thing.
One breaks the GDP hockey stick into regions. As you can see, there are a number of hockey sticks, but note that they don't rise at the same time.
The scientific community calls them hockey sticks.
Yeah, capitalism is the Industrial Revolution. I get it.
The year 1776 witnessed both the
Declaration of
Independence and the publication of a book called The Wealth of Nations.
That's when God published The Wealth of Nations and made America.
Free market capitalist economy and the benefits of doing so. America's wise founders took Smith's principles to heart, and within a mere 100 years, the blink of an eye historically, capitalism turned the United States from 13 backwoods colonies into the world's largest economy.
Yeah, no slavery, no nothing.
I wouldn't say that 100 years is a blink of an eye in human history.
And besides, like, to be honest, I'm a little surprised they even use Adam Smith, because like Adam Smith is so like incompatible with modern capitalist ideology and modern capitalist economics as well, because Adam Smith believed in like the labor theory of value and like believed in, he had much more in common with Marxism than any like modern day capitalism. He was critical of capitalism. He believed in labor theory of value, like all this.
Yeah. I mean, you
it's
know,
not it's, like they published fucking Wealth of Nations and then people are like, oh yeah, capitalism. Like,
yeah, no,
capitalism is already happening.
It's funny how they explain it. They're like, well, you know, the United States government, they honored the principle of Wealth of Nations and, you know, they just helped.
Yeah, it's almost like if Adam Smith like invented capitalism. Like, yeah. No, he just talked. He researched the already existing phenomena, and he wasn't even the first, far from it.
Yeah, you know, these Smithian U.S. politicians just, you know, held their eyes closed for a few seconds, and suddenly they're just the most powerful country in the world. There were no brutal military interventions and colonizations and all these various imperialist actions that were taken by the United States in order to expand its power and socioeconomic influence.
As far as I remember, Adam Smith doesn't say anything about slavery either.
Yeah.
But they still, apparently the Americans thought that that was important.
Yeah, no, that was, yeah. I mean, well, you know.
I wonder why.
It's held that position ever since. Western Europe shot up as well, but later. It rose steadily during the Industrial Revolution and then experienced a sharp rise after World War II when, between the end of the war and the mid-1960s, it fully embraced the free market. Japan too shot up after World War II, surpassing Western Europe for the first time after the U.S. helped the Japanese transition to a democracy and a free market capitalist economy. Eastern Europe took off after it was released from the Soviet Union and socialism in 1991.
China
That's not even what it says on the fucking graph. That's not even what it says. It says that they rose after World War II up until 2001. That's not 1990. It didn't go up in 1991. What are they talking about?
Yeah, it's pretty, I mean, it's kind of dishonest too, because obviously like the Soviet Union became, you know, they became the second biggest economy in the world way before that. It's just they take Eastern Europe as a whole, so the Soviet Union gets like disappears because they introduce like Bulgaria and Albania and all these countries that got their first railroads in the 50s.
Yeah.
And like, which is not even a lie. That's totally true. Like Albania got its, I think, first or second railroad and its first university after World War II.
Yeah.
So like,
you know, this is ridiculously dishonest, like obviously.
Yeah, I mean, if you look at it, like, the graph does not change an iota between the like where socialism is and where socialism ends. It just keeps going the same way as if nothing happened.
Yeah, no, like, of course it's perfectly fine.
Of what this guy's talking about.
Of course, it's perfectly fine for the United States to be measured in its own right, but the Soviet Union, no, they got to be grouped into Eastern Europe, and then they add in China there just because China is like
The Soviet economy or the Russian economy only started growing after 1991, even though it actually was cut in half in 1991.
What color each thing is?
Well, it's just, you know, the line. It's just the line on the right of the the text on the right of the line.
So a moron made the graph, basically. That's fine.
It also ends in 2001, which is kind of interesting. Well, anyway, it's so pointless to analyze this, pointless to take this seriously.
Clearly, India and Africa just did not embrace Smith enough.
I like how Africa is just one country.
Africa is socialist anyway.
Well, yeah, Africa failed to embrace Smithian economics, so that's
like Japan gets its own thing, but Africa...
Japan gets its own thing, but the Soviet Union, no.
China also doesn't get... Oh, wait, China is there.
Yeah, no, China's there,
China,
yeah.
China makes sense, but I don't know about Africa. Africans don't really make any sense.
Well, I thought they would
sense.
Leave China out just because they don't like them.
Yeah, that's true.
Yeah, well, but, it's obviously, like, completely dishonest.
...socialism and implemented some limited free market policies.
Can you feel your brain growing?
China. Oh, they're talking about, they're saying that, he just said that Dengism is what made China so much better.
Would be not
hell yeah, brother.
If its leaders had fully unleashed right. the forces of the free market. Yes, during this period of economic expansion, the wealthy got wealthier. That always happens when new wealth is created. But the middle class also greatly benefited.
Always.
Another telling chart. This one is from the World Bank.
Which is why they're poor.
In 1820, 94% of people lived in extreme poverty. Thanks to capitalism, by 2015, that number declined to 9.6%.
Wait. What?
In 1820...
So, hold on. So, capitalism started in 1820? Capitalism wasn't responsible for all of that poverty in the 19th century? Capitalism just came in 1820 and started making things better?
Today, there's only 10% of the people who are actually poor. That's interesting. Even though, like... Isn't it like 5 billion people who live on less than $10 per day? 5 billion people?
It's ridiculous. Even if it was true, it's still like, okay, 1 in every 10 people are living in squalid conditions, but it's fine.
Also,
1 in every 10 people.
Well, also, the other thing is that it depends on how you define poverty.
Because, well, obviously, I mean...
Because the poverty line, if they're using the poverty line in the United States... It doesn't take a lot into account. It leaves a lot of factors out. And if they're using some kind of global standard of poverty,
the way it works, they say like if you're like half the like something like 80% of the world lives on less than $10 per day.
Like
half the world. I think it's like half the world lives on like $2 per day, and then. Then there's like 1 or 2 billion who live on like $1 per day or something. They think like, well, if you're making $1 or like $2, then you're not poor anymore. Yeah. Like that's where the cutoff is. Like really, if you think about it, like the vast majority of the world is actually pretty damn poor if you think about it. But like, nah, it's a matter of like of standards.
Yeah, methodology.
94% of people lived in extreme poverty. Thanks to capitalism, by 2015, that number declined to 9.6%, single digits for the first time in human history. Now, it's still too many, but if we're going to reduce the number even more, we need to understand what caused the decline. Free market capitalism. If we combine the Angus Madison hockey stick chart and the World Bank data on extreme poverty, what we get is something quite
I can't believe that something like this actually exists. Like this is so like this is so gross like
a decline in poverty across the globe over the past 200 years. That's capitalism in a nutshell.
Like you can't get anything as blatant as this anywhere else. Historian
shows us how well ordinary people do when they work in a free market economy. Since 1990, Hunger, poverty, illiteracy, and child mortality have all declined significantly with the decline of socialism. This all happened while we added...
Wait, so you're saying that... So, yeah, when socialism was, like, the Russian Empire had no illiteracy, no hunger, then when the socialists took over, everybody was illiterate and hungry.
And child mortality was high.
And now mortality went up, and now, luckily, the mortality is going down again since there's no socialism.
The thing is, first of all, child mortality rates, the illiteracy, and the starvation rates were among the lowest in socialist countries. Those weren't the countries that were contributing to those higher percentages. Those were all capitalist countries that were contributing to those higher percentages.
That can't be right, Polinkosh. That must be some kind of Marxist.
Well, no, he's right, dude, because, I mean, it's like, you know, Thomas Sankara, he started an anti-vaxxer campaign in Burkina Faso. Not a lot of people know about that. I mean, well, like, Burkina Faso was 100% vaccinated before Thomas Sankara took over. Then he actually started vaccinating people.
Oh, yeah, yeah. He took syringes and he sucked out the vaccines from people. All the people who used to be vaccinated for all the diseases, like, he injected them with malaria, like, yeah, take this, you piece of shit. Like, he was like, everybody in Africa knew how to read, but he just, like, had people, like, hit them in the head, hit them in the head, like, really hard, so they lost their ability to read.
Yeah, he burned the books and he took a lead pipe to every citizen, to their back of their skull, and they're like, I can't read now. Because the goddamn communists.
Yeah. Mandatory lobotomy.
This is a lobotomy in the form of a video.
This is Prager's lobotomy.
Far less poverty, better health outcomes, fewer babies dying. That's what economic freedom, capitalism can do. President John while making his case for significant tax cuts in 1963... He said, a rising tide lifts all boats. Kennedy didn't believe that the poor only get richer when the rich get poorer. He believed everyone could get richer with economic growth.
And then he got shot in the head. Right.
This whole capitalism versus socialism debate is backwards. It's not those who advocate...
Look at those emojis.
...capitalism who need to justify their actions. Rather, it's those advocating for socialism or any form of it who have a lot of explaining to do.
Okay.
This video was made possible by.
No, fuck your endorsement.
Oh, dear. I mean, yeah, it just renders me speechless. Like, obviously, if you look at the actual facts, you know, Soviet Union was the second largest economy in the world. They eliminated illiteracy. They stopped hunger in the country. You know, it was still a difficult thing to do. They started from very backward conditions, and Eastern Europe as well, and Vietnam and Cuba and all those places started from backward conditions. But it's just ridiculous to say that, oh, these places were much better before. Then when socialism was introduced, like the Russian Tsar used to be flying around in space. Then the Soviets came and were like, okay, we're going back to the stone. We're going back to the medieval times now, like. Disassemble all the tractors, go back to wooden plows, like...
Well, that's true.
The Tsar used to have, like...
That's right.
...nuclear submarines.
Yeah, that's right.
That's right.
TVs and refrigerators.
Yeah, and, like, even when Mao took over, I mean, he instituted foot binding. I mean, like...
Oh, yeah.
Foot binding wasn't a thing, and then Mao took over, and he was like, we gotta bind all the feet. That's what it's about.
We gotta bind all the feet.
Yeah, Mao forced the Tibetan monks to, like, have slaves.
Yeah, true.
It was sad. So,
now we're going to do a video, Why Are So Many Americans in Prison?
Let's find out.
Before we do the video, I'm going to actually unmute a random person, and you can just comment and tell us what you think about that last PragerU video.
Random citizen on the street.
Random, yeah. Just type in the chat if you want to be unmuted. Type in the chat.
We got our journalist Chip Kipperson on the location right now interviewing a random.
So what do you think, Chip?
All right, I'm gonna unmute Trotsky Leon. All right, what do you think of that video?
Okay. So yeah, like I managed to watch like the second half of the video, but the graph I don't know. It just to me, it seems like too funny because the way they laid it out, as you said, they forgot completely about the USSR and they said, oh, it's just all Europe, East Europe. Like, yeah. Then I was questioning, like, why did not put Yugoslavia in there? Yugoslavia was not a part of that eastern part. It was, like, in its own thing.
No,
and
yeah,
Africa.
I mean, yeah.
Africa. Oh my God. Why just Africa? What about Canada? Like, I put in the comment section, Canada. Like, apparently Canada is nowhere to be found.
No, it's interesting that they have Africa in there. They're like, oh, yeah, Africa's poor because they don't have capitalism. And then, like, meanwhile, they don't even consider how, like, the West literally used to own Africa and all this. Like,
what about South Africa? Like, that country. That country was really doing well, right?
Yeah, no, I mean...
Did they even put, like, Latin America in there at all?
No, they didn't put Latin America, no.
Yeah,
no,
so South America just doesn't exist. So forget about that.
No, yeah, I mean, like it's hilarious. Like, it's so hilariously, like, dishonest. And the best part, I think, of that video was when they said that things didn't really improve in Eastern Europe until 1991, even though on their own fucking graph, it said 1950 is when it started going up. So it's which one is it?
Yeah, 1950s, which is when, that's when all those countries became socialists.
Yeah, plus me, like, as a fellow Yugoslav, I already know, like, that graph is just, like, making a bunch of stuff up. Because yeah. I mean, even like Yugoslavia, like when the communists took power, like, oh, evil Tito, when he took power, like a lot of things like were improving. Like you always had a job. You got food if you helped out.
Yeah, yeah, of course.
Yeah, this and that and that. And
this is every socialist country did.
But we almost went to space too, but of course we not had the money at the time. So
yeah, well, We should probably continue on to the next video. So thanks, Trotsky, hey, Leon, yeah, for giving your take.
Well, it is pretty fucked up how they excluded the entire global South. Like, just like, oh, sorry, what? Oh, South America, Africa. Oh, was that like a continent? Oh shit. Oh, sorry, man.
I'm sure on some level, like the people who watch it, they think like, yeah, communism equals poverty. Like things improved after communism. Like I can see how somebody watching that might think that, but you really have to think, like, do you think, like, Poland in the 1910s or 1920s was, like, more, like, better off than Poland in, like, the 1960s? Like...
Yeah, no.
Or, like, you know, like, what's the name of the, Nowa Huta? Like, the huge, like, industrial complex they built?
I have no idea.
Which,
not sure.
In Poland, it means, like, new factory or something.
I'm not sure.
I mean, basically, like, Poland is known for having huge, like, heavy industry. That's why they have, like, the environmental problems nowadays, because they used to have, like, these huge coal mines and, like, massive steel smelteries and, like, all this, which obviously caused environmental problems. But you honestly think that, like, at that level of industrial development didn't cause any, like, other kind of societal development? Like, people were better off in the 1910s when they were going on, like, with their horses and buggies and, like, their oxen.
Yeah.
Yeah, they were. Yeah. Definitely.
Without electricity.
Here, if speaking of Poland, I'm actually going to unmute a Polish person, so they can, because they want to speak. Hello? Pertanto?
Hello? Yes, Poland before World War II was horrible, actually. It was very large unemployment. But in this video that Prager was saying, he claimed that capitalism brings prosperity. And this is funny. I just listened yesterday to Parenti's speech where he actually talked about it. He said that those people say rising tide lifts all boats. And what Parenti answered is rising tide can sink lots of ships and drown lots of people. Okay, this is how usually they say about, you know, prosperity is shared by all of us in capitalism, which is not true. They actually take advantage of us. We sink. And he speaks that capitalism is good. How about capitalist Nigeria, Honduras, capitalist Indonesia? Nigeria, Honduras and Indonesia. These are all capitalist countries. Are they doing good? Not so really. And even the U.S., 4 years after the U.S. actually became the U.S., they had recession. They basically had recession every years, and we still do have like basically every 7 years recession in the US. So no, it's not true what they say. So yeah, I guess that's it, what I wanted to say.
Thank you. All right, let's now move on to the next video. Why are so many Americans in prison? Let's find out from PragerU today.
Our prisons are crowded with people who shouldn't be there, the victims of a racist justice system. This is the popular...
Damn, Prager being... This is some SJW...
Dangerously
wishy-washy liberal pinko stuff.
...have a very large prison population. Not because too many innocent
people... They even got a non-white person. What is this, PragerU? Identity politics.
Well, no, because it said... this is a progressive narrative. You go back and that's what it says. They're like, oh, this is what progressives say.
But it's wrong in every respect. Dangerously wrong.
Oh,
the
man.
The U.S. does have a very large prison population. Not because too many innocent people are incarcerated, but because too many people commit serious, usually violent crimes.
Yeah, yeah. If you have an ounce of weed, that's a violent crime.
A wildly violent crime. That is a sin against humanity.
Very serious crime.
Why are these savages committing all these crimes?
Why are these savages smoking marijuana? It's leading to mass violence.
Presenting the facts, let me add these caveats. It's unacceptable that any innocent person is behind bars. Punishment must always fit, not exceed, the crime. We should do everything we can to reduce the rates of recidivism, committing more crime after release. And finally, everyone in prison should be treated humanely. But let's not fool ourselves that our prisons are full of people who shouldn't be there. That's simply not the case. Let's start with those convicted of drug offense.
Before he gets into it, let's get into that. But before we even get into this fucking diarrhea that we're about to witness, why does the United States have 25% of the global prison population? Why
it's gone down. New York has the lowest prison population it's ever had since 1946 now because of the coronavirus. So they're like, oh, actually, you don't need to be.
Oh, yeah, like, man. I mean, yeah, it's like the joke, like, we did it. We went like a month without having a mass shooting. Like,
yeah.
Yeah, no, that shit is.
No, but like some of these lunatics, like I've seen them actually say that America only has so much crime because they're like ethnically diverse versus like European countries.
Oh God,
I don't know what other explanation they could have.
So then, what about the Soviet Union then? Like, sure,
I mean,
it wasn't as ethnic, but it wasn't as ethnically diverse, but it was to some degree.
It was very very diverse. I mean, basically, they want to blame black people for everything, but...
Yeah.
I mean, well, all right, let's be serious for a second. So, like, sure, tons of Americans commit serious crimes. There's, like, gang violence, murder, assault, like, all this obviously goes on. But, you know, shouldn't we look at the social conditions that cause that? Like, and that also causes recidivism. Like, people who live in a... alienating, violent, militarized culture. They have no prospects in life. They commit crimes. They go in prison. They get they get forced to join gangs. Then when they go get out of prison, they get right back into it because there's nothing. The society doesn't take care of them. Doesn't give them opportunities. The society should make sure that when a person gets out of prison, there's a place for them to go. They have a job or education already prepared where they can go, and you know, whatever, if they have drug problems, whatever, people, the society shouldn't just neglect them and just like, oh yeah, just throw them out there into the right back into the ghetto and like hope nothing bad happens. Like, oh, that's ridiculous.
Oh,
I mean,
shit.
But that is laissez-faire, I suppose. It is laissez-faire.
Oh shit, okay, hold on, my boy Adrian's here now. Okay, cool, all right. What's going on, Aztec?
Sorry about that, boys. Doing fine.
All right. Well, I'm conscripting you to join us in Big Brain University in reacting to these videos.
That's fine by me, buddy.
Okay. All right. Yeah. So and also, here's the thing about all of the things that he listed before about, like, you know, reducing recidivism, all this other shit. I mean, like you said, Finney, All of this shit can be resolved through like socialist rehabilitation, like socialist rehabilitative justice. And that's exactly what I talked about in like, I think it was my second video that I ever released about rehabilitation. And I'm sure that like this will broadly apply to every single point made in this fucking video. So
it's not like they don't have like drug court or like drug programs at prisons. Like most of them have that. But the problem is like when you get out, you got to pay shitloads of court fees. And like you said, like you're sent back into the ghetto or wherever.
Yeah.
You're living.
Well, the rehabilitation,
you can actually parole. You can parole out into a fucking homeless shelter. I mean, think about that. Think about like the type of shit you're going to see. Being homeless in a homeless shelter and being on fucking parole and expected not to do drugs, you know?
Yeah, well, so, and the other thing is, like, I mean, even
the homelessness is a massive thing. Like, that's the thing. Like, when people, they don't have any legitimate source of money, and they also don't have anything to do. So then, those two things put together, like, okay, you're gonna drink, you're gonna do drugs, you're gonna do stupid things, and to get money, you're gonna steal or whatever.
Prostitute. Which is illegal, so.
Yeah, well, I mean, but rehabilitation is not just like, you know, drug programs and prisons. Like rehabilitative justice is like, you know, giving basically like training these inmates to become working class proletarians who are committed, participate in society in a more positive way. If they offered like job training, not if they offered it, but if they made job training mandatory in justice system, I think that a lot of these supposed criminals could just get back into society. And
well, a lot of them have job training, but it's just the way that people are treated, like the way that the cells are set up, and like it's just fucking inhumane. Like the cell, like, they don't have like ladders on the bunk beds, so people like get on their bed and then fucking fall and break their neck half the time. Just shit like that, like little things like that. It just makes them think that they're shit, so that when they get out, they act like shit. You know what I mean?
Even the way the American like prisons are set up, the way that they like my understanding of American prisons basically comes from like the Prison Break TV show. The classic thing where you're in a cell with another person, and then there's like one wall that's like open, like that like not having any privacy or any security, like the fact that like I've seen people who like who've been in prison and they say that you can't ever like sleep with the like unless the door is closed or you have somebody watching over you, otherwise somebody's gonna come in and stab you, steal from you, like do whatever, like just that is crazy to me. Like, that's gonna make anybody into a, that's gonna give you PTSD, give you like whatever. That's gonna make anybody go crazy.
It's gonna turn anybody into a sociopath.
You're gonna become like complete psycho. Like, if you constantly have to like fight for your life, like see everybody as a threat.
At the very least, sociopathic. And I mean, that's what we see with,
you can't not be able to trust anyone and shit like that.
Yeah. Hey, PRP wanted to say something.
Yo, hey. So, I just wanted to say, I really hate that word, recidivism.
Mm-hmm.
Because, like, I feel like you go up to any liberal, right, and or at least most liberals, and you ask them, oh, what do you think is wrong with the prison system? And they'll be like, oh, it starts with race and ends with ism. Can you guess it? It's recidivism. And it's like, I hate it because they claim that these people have, like, criminal records, right, is what they do. And they say, oh, those people were just good or those people were just bad. But it's more that the rule of law is applied unequally, essentially, between different minorities.
Yeah.
There's
and
this
rich,
some...
and rich and poor, too.
Yeah. Well, I mean, you know, class on class basis more than anything else, of course.
But there's this really good video that I saw from these people called Juice Media, and they're like a bunch of like sock dems, but they make really good content. And one of the videos that they made was on Black Lives Matter and the whole background behind the preschool to prison pipeline and how the whole system is just literally just set up so that poor neighborhoods, most often, you know, minority neighborhoods, predominantly Black and Latino, have lesser funding for education because of redlining. Lesser funding from education leads to less chances of getting a good degree or a good job, which leads to less income for the area. Property value becomes devalued because of the redlining, or the legacy of redlining, rather. And then from there, you have a system where these people essentially just go through school, fail it, join a gang, do stuff, go to prison, come out. There's no system for rehabilitation. So then they just go like straight back to prison. And obviously this is part of a larger like capitalist issue, problem.
And the prisons make money too. They make money like per
bed. Yeah, because our prisons are privatized. Say, so that's a whole other level of like bullfuckery.
And people say there's no such thing as modern slavery.
Yeah.
In Western countries. Well,
slavery is still legal under the 13th Amendment if you're a prisoner.
I mean, it's actually legal to be a slave in the U.S. Constitution if you're a prisoner. That's like, that exists.
If you think about it, like, what's the difference, right, between for the Black community at large, what's the difference, and the Latino community, what's the difference between an overseer and a police officer at that point? Like, you can get a picture of Black people working on a plantation in the 1800s with a white overseer on a horse and put it right next to a picture of a line of Black inmates carrying tools to go work on something while an overseer cop is sitting on a horse watching them.
Yeah,
and Angola. You can't tell the difference.
Yeah, Angola prison. Yeah, Black people pick cotton.
Yeah,
and if you're in danger or somebody commits a crime against you, like you call the cops might just kill you. So,
yeah,
you can't even legitimately say that they're like protecting you because they're just really protecting themselves. Like they might if
yeah,
I mean we've all seen a million stories like about the some. Non-white person calls or even a white person, like especially if you're they can arbitrarily kill anyone, but if you're a Black or if mentally ill, you have like you're in serious danger like from the police.
But yeah, let's continue with the video.
So much of the mass incarceration myth, while it's true that
the mass incarceration myth
incarcerated on drug charges, federal inmates constitute only about 12% of the American prison population. Almost 9 of every 10 prison inmates are in state facilities, and very few of them, less than 15%, are there for drug-related offenses.
That's bullshit. 4 times
that number are behind bars for one of the following serious crimes. Murder, 14%. Rape or sexual assault, 13%. Robbery, 13%. Aggravated or simple assault, 11%. And burglary, 9%. In short,
violence... So you know what? Wait, stop.
...majority of the state prison...
Robbery, okay, that's a money-based fucking issue. And aggravated and simple assault is, like, bar fights. Burglary is fucking B&E. Also, a wealth-related problem. So, like, really, like, two of the main ones on here into money. This is definitely worth pointing out in the whole simple assault. I mean, fucking, dude, simple assault is literally, like, fucking spitting on someone or, like, slapping someone. They're like, oh, these are serious fucking crimes. You know, you get in a fucking
these
bar
are violent criminals. Yeah.
I mean, well, even assault is violent, but
even murder, like, you know, how many what they call murder is really just like it's just some other kind of crime. Like it, so many people die.
Including like manslaughter? Like,
well, they're gonna call it like what's the term? Like, even if you're like you drive like the getaway vehicle, and they go in and rob a bank, and somebody dies in the process,
you get murder. Yeah,
there's a special term for it. It's like some special kind of murder that they. But you all get homicide, even if that's when somebody thinks of murder, you think like, okay, I've plotted for 3 weeks, I'm gonna, you know, poison my grandma or something, but it's not really like that.
Yeah, and even like robbery and burglary, it's like, yeah, like you, those are definitely things you should not do, but at the same time it's
these are strictly class related issues.
Yeah, of course they're class related issues. And second of all, like the sentences for this shit, I mean, fucking say like unarmed robbery, I mean that shit in certain states that shit carries like 10 to like 20 fucking years. And it's like, yeah, motherfucker's tweaking and he wants drugs, so he walks into the fucking 7-Eleven and right, like that's, you shouldn't do that. But at the same time, I don't think motherfuckers should be sitting in fucking prison for goddamn, you know, state penitentiary for like 20 years for that shit. I mean, it's ridiculous.
Yeah, and especially, you know, not getting really any opportunities before or after. So
yeah,
the population What's more, drug offenders who do end up in prison don't actually serve very much time. Almost half are released within a year. The truth is that most criminals probably spend less time in prison than you think.
Depends on the fucking state. That super depends on the state.
That's, it depends on a lot of things. Depends on the prosecutor, generalizing the judge, lawyer, your charge, like what you know, what seriousness of the charge, like what's happening in the charge, like.
Yeah, for example, in the South, like black people are incarcerated for drug offenses completely disproportionately to other parts of the United States, and they're also held in prison for a lot longer, completely disproportionately to other parts of the United States. So generalizing in such a way, and like looking at all United States prisoners, like. At the same time, it's really, really fucking dishonest.
There's such a thing as mandatory minimums, too. This fucking guy leaves that shit out conveniently.
What's the actual explanation, though? Like, why are so many Americans in prison? They're just crazy? Like, what's the actual explanation,
No, the explanation is they're bad people, so they deserve to be there.
Americans are just worse people. Very unpatriotic of you, Prager. Yeah,
but we have the best economy.
Yeah.
But yeah, capitalism creates the best economy, but with the most amount of bad people. I don't know. I don't know what the fuck. Yeah.
Can't win them all.
Yeah, I guess not.
Yo, is Aztec even here right now? Why the fuck is this guy not talking? Oh, he's server muted. Who server muted you?
Great.
Damn. that's racist.
Hello? Can anyone hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you, yeah.
He's just there, can anybody hear me? Hello?
He was muted that whole time.
Oh, man. No, never mind.
He's so defeated. He's bad. So he probably was talking the whole time. He's like, oh, fuck.
That's sad.
There are shitty points anyways.
Oh, yeah. Okay.
According to the Bureau of Justice Statistics, almost 40% of released state prisoners served less than a year in prison. Even 20% of murderers and nearly 60% of those convicted of rape or sexual assault served less than 5 years in prison. What explains the short stays? Answer, plea bargaining. Most prosecutions never go to court. Instead, a deal is made between the defendant's attorney and the prosecutor to avoid going to trial. These negotiations often involve the offender agreeing to plead guilty in exchange for a reduced sentence or dropping or downgrading the most serious charges. As a result,
you know, what's your guys' opinion on plea bargains?
Hold the fuck on. Let me talk about this, because he just skipped over, like, three really important things.
It seems very questionable to me that...
Zach is a Jacobin has had experience in the justice system, so let's let him...
Like, to me, literally, it seems very questionable.
The reason why they take plea bargains is because if you go to trial and fucking lose, you get sent to the maximum amount of time for that crime. So that's why no one wants to do it. Especially if you get a public defender who's, like, getting paid like shit and it deals with fucking 3,000 cases a year. Like, no, you're not going to take it to trial. You're going to take the plea bargain. That's how a lot of innocent people end up getting convicted. They don't take it to trial. They're like, well, you know, you could lose. Like, okay, you're innocent, so you could spend 6 years in prison, or you could lose at trial and spend 20 years in prison. Which one do you want? And you're like, well, fuck me, I guess. I guess I'm doing 6 years. That's the reality for most.
Yeah, to me, it doesn't seem like if you let's say you rob a bank or you steal money, and then there's a trial. Like, aren't they supposed to figure out what happened and then like just let the system like do it? Isn't like I don't understand this. Like, why do they need to have this thing? Like, well, okay, so we basically just intimidate the crap out of you and tell you like, okay, well. You have to confess you have to say you're guilty, even if you might not be, just, and then we'll give you a reduced sentence. Otherwise, like, you don't know what's going to happen. Like, because I don't see,
yeah,
what's the point of plea bargains? If they could find you guilty, why don't they just find you guilty? Like, why do they need to, like, we'll make a deal. You just confess and say you're guilty, man.
Well, it's because like, what I just said, because if you get convicted at trial, you are fucked. Like, you're doing like the maximum.
Yeah, but but from this point of view of justice, it doesn't make any sense. It just
the way they see it is like they're making the court spend money on the trial, which takes a long time and costs a lot of money.
That is heartless. That
landed him behind bars in the first place. For example, an armed burglar who, when arrested, was found to be in possession of illegal drugs, might go to prison not for his worst crime, the armed burglary, but for a plea bargain charge of, say, trespass and drug possession. But the media and the activists don't tell us about this rather important detail. Instead, all we hear about is the poor fellow who's serving time for selling a small amount of cocaine. This assumes, of course, that the convicted criminal does any time at all. Studies done by the Justice Department show that only
about really, we should be felony convictions arresting even more people.
Yeah, we should be okay, arresting but more people. We should be spending more money on Israel.
But what if all he was doing was trespassing with drugs, though, and the prosecutor charged him with armed burglary? You know what I mean? It's like, yeah, they're gonna come out with like the craziest charge, like anything they can slap on you. That's their job. That's what they're paid to do. That's the whole fucking point. Yeah, you know what I mean? Like, otherwise, you would be out of a job for a prosecutor. Just, you weren't doing that.
Yeah, just because the prosecutor said it's an armed burglary doesn't make it so, right? I mean,
yeah, clearly, he's like not even recognizing the legitimacy of the court he's defending. It's like, okay, they charged him with this, but he wasn't convicted of that. Oh, but he's still guilty of it because they charged him with it. Like, this dude's a fucking moron.
And clearly he's like, clearly, like, the whole theme of this video is we need to put more people in prison, which is just fucking so funny.
Bro, yeah. You don't get it. We need more people in prison for the slave. I mean, prisons.
Bad people.
Bad people, yeah.
Yeah,
he's literally people. Just trying to explain, like, how really the American justice system is great, and everybody who's in prison is actually not just a non-violent, you know, guy who had a little bit of weed or something. Actually, they're all, like, these mega-violent gangsters, and they all deserve it, and it's all completely justified. So, like, my question is, why are Americans all like these mega gangsters? Like, why are they all committing these horrible violent crimes?
Why does America have 25% of the world's violent gangsters?
It's all because of 50 Cent.
Can I just say that one thing where he was saying, like, people in prison spend most people in prison only spend like a year. Like, most places won't even sentence you to, like, he must be talking about jail or something. This is the difference between jail and prison. Like, if you're going to prison, you're usually going to be there for at least, like, 2 years, 3 years, you know what I mean? Otherwise, they're just going to put you in county jail, because it's not worth it to send you to prison. So this dude is just full of shit, like, every which fucking way.
...in probation, sentenced to home confinement, or given credit for time served in pretrial detention. But most of the time, convicted criminals don't go to prison. Do we really want even more criminals out on the street? Activists say yes. Scholars at the left-leaning
activists right. Say yes.
Man, that's a
activists that's a, say we need more criminals on the streets. That's, a that's cool what way activists of say.
Yes,
that is your general opinion, Jen.
I think I want more criminals on the streets. To be honest with you, you know, we have more.
We're criminals. Here today protesting. We're here. We're out here. We want more criminals on the street.
Back to you.
More criminals! That's what activists are saying. Jesus Christ.
...in the number of inmates. CNN host Van Jones, founder of the hashtag Cut50 initiative, tops that. He wants a 50% reduction. But if the activists get their way...
Oh no! Less people in prison making the prisons bank. Oh God. How terrible.
Those bastards of the Innocent Project, bro. Fucking pieces of shit.
Yeah, no, this is like, PragerU is to that as fucking hunters are to PETA.
Yeah.
The cost would be high and would likely be paid by the most vulnerable. Most crimes are committed by a small fraction of the population who primarily victimize their own communities.
Black people.
Oh, God.
Black
people. In the spring of 2019, two men were charged.
I mean, do you think it's a coincidence they got a non-white person to do this video? Like,
do you think it's a coincidence that they, like, they only fucking put the shoes of the characters? They didn't put the color of their skin?
Oh, Jesus.
To be honest, like, I'm a little surprised that they were, like, smart enough to put a non-white person. I mean...
Yeah.
Usually they're so horrible.
What if it was two black people and like a white pregnant woman?
Oh, Jesus. Fuck.
Oh, my God.
I mean, you might as well just throw, like a fucking dude who retired from, like, the Gestapo and shit.
If they did that, I think Prager, you would have to delete their channel. Oh, dude.
Baby.
Oh,
fuck. Well, let's hear what happened here.
In 2019, two men were charged with the murder of a Chicago woman who was shot while holding her baby. One of the men charged had 9 felony convictions, including for a 2004 second-degree murder charge. A January 2017 University of Chicago Crime Lab study found that on average, someone arrested for a homicide or shooting in that city had nearly 12 prior arrests. Almost 20% had more than 20. If we cut prison rolls...
Yeah, you know 20, why?
Yeah, that's arrests.
Okay,
that's
but why?
Arrests, yeah. Not convictions.
Yeah, but those are...
Only 20 arrests? Like, Jesus.
Yeah, but usually... Usually a person starts with lesser crimes, and then they work their way. Like, if you live in the slums for, like, decades, like, you start with some petty theft, then eventually, over the years, you might end up in an altercation where somebody dies. That's how it happens. It is not like this Hercule Poirot type fucking thing where you just, like, you're a perfectly upstanding citizen, and then one day you just, like, decide to commit a murder. Like, no, it doesn't usually happen like that.
Yeah, also, it's like, oh, he was incarcerated and committed one 19. It's like, yeah, so he spent 15 years in prison, right? That's what you wanted? Spent 15 years in prison, comes out and murders again. Yeah, like, so what's your solution? Do I do, like, fucking 35 years in prison? Like, what, you think that's going to make a difference? Like, what's the difference between 15 and 35 years in prison? You know what I mean? Like, what's the solution?
50%. It won't be politicians and media celebrities living in gated communities who will pay the price. It will be the law-abiding citizens and underserved neighborhoods struggling to get ahead who will pay. When it comes to debates about criminal justice policy, these people, not criminals, should come first. I'm Rafael Mengual, Deputy Director of Legal Policy at the Manhattan Institute for Prager University. Thank you
the
for
problem
watching
with that video. Logic
keep
is that
you videos free.
Sure.
Please.
Sure, the obviously the people who live in the ghetto, they also want less crime, but obviously whatever they're doing right now isn't working. While they do want less crime and more security, more safety, which also means that they want the police to not just, like, wantonly murder them, but they also don't want their family members, friends, and co-workers to just be arrested willy-nilly.
What was this guy's name, anyway? I want to look him up, because I bet you he's, like, a prosecutor or some shit.
What he said, I just want to didn't see he say name. Something like that?
No, he said he's at some on some legal shit. I'm curious about his background. Rafael Mengual. Okay, thanks.
Deputy Director of Legal Policy. Oh, god damn.
He holds a BA in Corporate Communications. Yeah, whatever.
Well, it didn't really explain why so many Americans are in prison. Just said that it's all their own fault, and they deserve it. System works just fine. Keep moving.
I mean, y'all is gonna get more poor. I mean, we don't have to pay for shit. We're fucking cool.
Yeah, exactly.
So this guy was never actually, like, anything, according to his, like, little biography.
Well, it was, like, the only person who wasn't white that they could find.
Yeah.
Anyway, who wants to be unmuted to respond to the video? Okay, I'll do Big Papa. Go ahead, Big Papa.
Hey, yeah, so... I think my biggest problem with this was they never addressed why we have, like, you know, they never addressed, you know, the whole point of the video. And I think it is the fact the prison system has created a criminal environment in many places where I was commenting a lot on this, where some communities, they've been so gutted by mass incarceration that there's just a complete brain drain. And it leads to even more crime, which, all you know, it comes with lack of trust in the police, you know, which, again, leads to more. I was explaining this in the comments, but in a lot of places, not too near, but kind of, like, the question is not if I will go to prison, it is when I will go to prison because of this, which is big, big problem, obviously.
Thank you. Thank you, Big Papa, explaining that big problem.
Thank you. Also, can we do conservatives are the real environments, environmentalists?
Conservatives are real environmentalists. I don't know. I wanna try a non-Prager one next.
To give you an idea, like, so Prager, they don't really explain why America has such a problem with crime. They didn't come out and say it's because there's black people, but, I mean, that's usually the excuse. But if you look at Finland, for example, like, Finland used to have a lot more crime than it does now. Like, in the 1920s, it was the most dangerous time in Finnish history, and it's not because Finnish people all of a sudden just got, like, all crazy or something. No, it was because of material conditions. Like, it was right after the revolution, civil war, whatever. Like, tons of people were in prison for, as, like, political prisoners, and they were getting out. There was prohibition, like, prohibition of alcohol, which caused a lot of, like, black market violence. There was a murder every single day. Basically, like, there was insane poverty, complete, like, fascist, and it caused a ton of violent crime. Obviously, now that conditions are better, people have more opportunities. They don't have to, like, literally kill each other for like, scraps to eke out a horrible living. But no, I'm sure it's just some other unrelated reason.
Does anybody else want to say something before we continue on to the next video?
People like to do crime. I don't know what it is. They just.
Yeah,
they
man,
just
my like name it. Is Garfield Lasagna.
All right, Oceania, you can go ahead.
What's up? So, I think I lost a couple of brain cells just watching those videos, so you gotta give me a minute. The prison system here, they didn't even get to the bulk of it. Of course, it's not. They're not, because it's not. They're gonna show the issues, and they don't want that. And, capitalism's the cause of it, you know, because people are poor and they have no other way to survive, so they have to steal bread or have to steal this or that to pawn it so they could get money. And those people are punished worse than the murderers and rapists. So that's all I have to say.
Thank you.
I mean, I was joking about 50 Cent, but if you like, you know, they made a movie about his life, and he's like, the movie is not nearly as insane as his life actually is. Like, the movie feels fake, but it's like his life was actually, like, his childhood was insane. Like, he was selling, like, his mom was a crack dealer who died when he was like 9. Then he started selling crack at like age 13 or something. Can you imagine, like, those conditions? He said, like, the price to get somebody assassinated on his street was like, I don't remember how much, like $500 or something, maybe even not that much.
Damn.
Jesus.
I don't know. So.
That's crazy. 50 Cent. 50 Cent.
Just the social conditions, like, and he's just like one in hundreds of thousands of other people who live there. He's just like the guy who became famous, but.
Yeah.
Niggas screw they face up at me on some real shit, son, they don't want beef. I cock that, aim that shit out the window and spray the inner cell up in my heat. Y'all niggas better lay down, y'all mean stay down. Get hit with a cane round, hands ain't gon' make it. You niggas will get laid out, the blood in your brains out. Hey, you on the concrete, syrup in the sick, and I'm from Southside, motherfucker. With them gets explode, if you feel like you're on fire, boy, drop and roll. Niggas, they heat your ass up, cause they heart turn cold. Now you could be a victim, or you can lock and load. The party jumps.